headlines like those were seen on sports pages nationwide during the great Pinoy boxing era in America from 1921 through the 1940s. Up and down the West Coast and across the nation, Pinoy boxers possessed the reputation of being flashy, tireless crowd pleasers. The great era evolved from the introduction of the sport by the American military in the Philippines. Boxing quickly became a popular sport in the Philippines, and the best of the Filipino boxers soon attracted promoters who would bring them to America and into the ring before a worldwide audience. The great era continued to flourish for nearly three decades with a steady recruitment and the high level of success of those boxers. Ultimately, it faded with changing immigration patterns as well as changes during World War II in both the Philippines and America. The great Pinoy boxing era produced a generation of heroes for the Filipino community, heroes scarcely recognized in today's history books. However, the great era lives on in the memories of those who were there to experience it, for it gave them not only heroes, but a sense of identity and a hope for equality as well. The great Pinoy boxing era was indeed a symbolic chapter in our Filipino-American experience.
If my memory does not fail me, boxing was introduced in the Philippines as early as 1898 when the American soldiers came storming into Manila Bay. Being fond of anything pertaining to sports, anything pertaining to fights particularly, and having the fighting spirit besides, the Filipinos were naturally attracted to the boxing game. Those American soldiers already knew boxing. They had tournaments at their barracks. They taught the Filipinos about boxing. But the Filipinos knew how to fight already. They got that Kali, Eskrima, Arnis, you know? They developed their own style boxing. Before you know, they have boxing in every city and region. And that Olympic Stadium in Manila is the palace of boxing in the Philippines.
Western boxing involved frontward outstretched arms for deflecting punches and a slower flat-footed shuffle for movement. On the other hand, the Filipinos used tucked-in arms, a bobbing head for dodging punches, and quick triangular shifting of the feet for mobility. All of these concepts reminiscent of Kali, Eskrima, and Arnis techniques. This coiled-up stance facilitated the use of a counterpunch. Nothing new to Philippine-style fighting, but a revolution to the Western technique. With the Philippine influence on fighting technique, boxing as the world knew it would never be the same. The style and the players of the game now had a Philippine accent. The skill of the Filipino boxers quickly reached world-class level. The best of the boxers ventured out of the Philippines to claim titles of nearby Australia and the Orient. Soon they began to attract American boxing promoters. Frank Churchill and Joe Waterman were the top American recruiters in the Philippines. Their gamble on the new foreign fighters would see huge payoffs back in the U.S. Jess Cortez and Johnny Sampson were highly successful Filipinos who likewise brought young boxing talents to America. The Filipino boxers recruited to the U.S. were only the country's best.
So when they came here to this country, they were main eventers. I tell you the truth, I don't remember a Filipino fighter that is as a four-round fighter, six-round fighter. And they were little guys, you know, 119, 18-pound bantamweights, you know. Speed was the name of the game and endurance, and they had it. They had it in them days.
Coming to America, the boxers left behind their fans and countrymen only to be greeted by enthusiastic immigrant Filipinos, or Pinoys as they called themselves. The new boxing Pinoys came from all regions of the Philippines, and although they spoke different dialects, they equally shared in the pursuit of this American dream.
Huwag mo suntukin sa mukha.
Suntukin mo sa mukha. Nangapag ka, hindi nasugat ako.
Huwag ka magsuntok ganito, huwag ka maganyan, ganyan, ganyan.
Huwag. Pancho Villa put the Philippines on the map as the first Pinoy to emerge as a world champion. His career took off in a flurry of events. Unfortunately, his end came just as quickly. Villa came to the U.S. in May 1921. He quickly became a world-class contender and won the world's flyweight championship in September 1923. Just 2 years later, at the peak of his career, he made a choice that would cost him his life. Villa was to fight Jimmy McLarnon on July 4, 1925 in the Emeryville ballpark. He had an infected wisdom tooth and was advised to call the fight off. Not wanting to disappoint his countrymen, who had come from all over California and had sacrificed precious work to see him fight, he went on with the match. He lost the non-title fight in a decision, and the blows to his jaw severely aggravated his condition. 10 days following the fight, he was taken to the hospital where they pulled the infected tooth. Blood poisoning spread throughout his system, and he died at the height of his career. He was only 23 years old and still the champion. His body was shipped home for burial, and the homeland mourned his death. The entire boxing world mourned the loss of Pancho Villa. Pancho Villa's fame inspired future Pinoy boxers. He set the stage for the great Pinoy boxing era.
Growing up, we always were at the fights, you know. The Filipino kids, most of the Filipino boys and a lot of the women, we'd go to the fights and they were all like our sports idols. We didn't have anybody else to look up to. But these Filipino fighters were always attractive and they'd import them over the years because they knew their countrymen would go see them.
Pinoy boxers were in high demand and a steady stream of recruits from the Philippines supplied that demand.
They had the following. They had the following of the people that would pack the Olympic Auditorium. The Olympic Auditorium held 10,000 people at that time. It was packed, sold out, every time.
And so you walk in there, and wham, it's just like a wall. You can smell the Tuscany, right? Whack, boy, there's Filipinos around here. And you look around, and nothing but Filipinos all over the place.
The best years that I remember, in the year 1929, because 1929, I just arrived here. I already noticed that there are two, three Filipinos are already holding the state title from flyweight, bantamweight, and welterweight.
During the peak of the era, Pinoy boxers could be seen in cities across the country. They fought before full house crowds in arenas of the big boxing cities like Madison Square Garden of New York, Olympic Auditorium of Los Angeles, and Dreamland Arena of San Francisco.
I put in San Francisco, Stockton, Sacramento, Fresno, Pismo Beach.
Reflecting the migratory patterns of Filipinos in California and Washington, smaller boxing hubs sprang up all along the West Coast. Places with Filipino populations like Stockton, Pismo Beach, Bakersfield, Watsonville, Tacoma, and Seattle became part of the West Coast boxing circuit, largely due to the massive following a Pinoy boxer would attract there. Good Pinoy boxers were a gold mine to promoters. Because of this, the steady recruitment continued for nearly three decades. The breeding grounds for Pinoy fighters would not be limited to the Philippines. Talented Pinoy recruits began coming from Hawaii in the early 1930s.
Every plantation had Filipino boxers. And you had a culling out process there. By the time those boxers got to Honolulu, they were proven people in the outer islands. That's where all the recruiters would focus, would be on Honolulu, because they had boxed their way up as club boxers. And that's how we were fortunate to get the great John Ifan. When he came to the West Coast, he had been recruited already.
Remigio Javalana, called Kid Java in the ring, was a rising boxing star in Hawaii during the 1930s.
Kauai champion. Hawaii champion, they call it. Hawaii. My leg was so good, you know.
and I had good condition, see? That's why I knock out everybody. That's why my record says in there, 45 fights, all knockout. World champion, that's what I came for. That's why I came up the mainland here, to fight the world champion, you know. And he refused me, because he got a big cut on the eye.
His title shot never came, but like so many of his fellow Pinoy boxers of the era, he was a champion to the Filipino people. Robert Ilado, also known as Little Dempsey, boxed his way to America in 1932.
My fighting name is Little Dempsey, and I'm from Negros Occidental, just Bacolod, that thing. When I see all this boxer and I heard about Pancho Villa, then I changed my mind. I want to be a boxer. I don't want to learn anymore, you know. So I ran away. One guy, American guy, he saw me fighting in Cebu. And he said, "Boy, you fight like Jack Dempsey." So he said, "Why don't you change your name as Jack Dempsey, Lel Dempsey?" So I changed my name, Lel Dempsey. When I went to Manila, I stayed in Manila. And I was fighting already many bin, turned around, and somebody told me to, he said, "You want to go with me to America?" "Why, sure, right away." I come over with Lel Pancho, Small Montana, and myself. My first fight, I was in Sacramento. I win that fight. When I go to Stockton, when they see me, they recognize me, they always holler, "Hey, Dempsey!" 1932, still the prison. And I put Del Barba and Lolo, I got $1,000.
Like his fellow Filipinos of the day, he had his own way of surviving in a land of racism and prejudice.
This woman is hollering, "Come on, come on, kill that monkey," you know. And I hold the guy, you know, I hold the guy, and I show her he was in the corner. And then we're still fighting. And once we went to that corner, I hold the guy and twist it, and I blow my nose blood, you know. And he keep quiet.
In a time when Filipinos were prohibited from interracial marriage, ownership of land, and citizenship, the boxers served as tokens of pride in being Filipino-American.
Filipino boxers were heroes, of course. They were our crusaders, and so much as carrying our banner before the American public.
We now like Espinidado or Ciprino Garza. When they get those, especially those state champions, or American champion, boy, we have a big what you call parade in town. Yeah, we are proud that we have a Filipino famous boxer in United States.
Ray and Jerry Pilar recall their boyhood hero, boxer Jimmy Florida.
I remember bragging to the kids at this grammar school we went to, Dayton Heights, and we had this Filipino fighter coming on at the Olympic, and he's fighting this guy named Halosino.
They called him the Japanese Sandman. And the Japanese Sandman was known, his reputation was no one ever got beyond the first four rounds because he'd put him to sleep with a knockout punch. The school I went to was primarily Japanese. We were the only Filipino family in the whole school.
And if I remember right, Jimmy knocked this guy out in the first round.
You know what took place the next day when I went back to school. The only Filipino family in the school walked down the hall, you know, with the chin raised high, and Jimmy sort of put the entire school on notice that we've arrived, you know.
That the guys who set foot in the ring knew damn well that they were fighting as Filipinos. And they knew the esteem with which they were held by other Filipinos. For people at the bottom who have very little, it's important to have heroes. And these guys, in the eyes of my dad's generation, were heroic people. The ring was one of the few places in American society where Filipinos could participate as equals. It was a chance to suspend reality, you know, for an evening and see a Filipino really do well.
Well, when we see the Filipino is winning, you are also like happy because our people is winning.
It made us feel, well, we were gaining some recognition here in this world. This was a tough world.
The minute he stepped in the ring, I mean, he was us, average Mr. Joe Filipino, okay? And so he was carrying the banner for us, whatever frustrations we had that day or that week, whatever hurts, he was going to carry the banner for us and wreak revenge on society for us.
Gave them hope, symbolic hope, but you know, people have to have symbols as well as real progress. And the fighters provided that. It was something that knit a community, their presence knit a community together.
The first common denominator, without question, that brought them together more than anything else was boxing. Because they didn't care if a person was a Visayan or Ilocano, Tagalog, Boholano, Cebuano. In a foreign country, they were taking on the world. And you can just see the expressions on their faces in the auditoriums, especially when the Pinoy come out winner. The Ilocano was embracing the Visayan, the Tagalog didn't care anymore. There was no differences. And this was bringing them together, and they didn't even know it.
Agrifino Garcia won the world's middleweight championship in October 1939. With his patented bolo punch, he thrilled audiences around the globe from 1932 to 1945. He was one of the greatest Pinoy boxers of all time. However, he was not your typical Filipino.
But when you talk about Filipinos, they were small as a rule. You very seldom see a big guy. When you see one like Agrifino Garcia, that's odd, you know, middleweight. But he was a great fighter, Agrifino Garcia. You know, he was champion, middleweight champion of the world.
As a boy in the Philippines, Agrifino worked the fields, chopping sugarcane. Harvest after harvest, he'd swing the bolo knife with a stroke that resembled a blend of a right hook and an uppercut. This was the development of one of the most devastating punches in boxing.
He's the one who invented the bolo punch. And they talked so much, and they built it up a big deal. The bolo punch, you know, coming around. It was sort of like a winding up uppercut. That's what it was. But he says he developed from the sugar cane. He used to cut, you know. That's where he got the movement for it.
For Filipino Americans of the day, boxing was one of the few public sources of entertainment available. Also relegated to taxi dance halls and gambling houses, the Pinoys had few outlets for recreation.
Life is bad, but when there is a fight, that's the time you can see lots of Filipinos.
The interest was great. Filipinos and Mexicans, they love boxing. They love boxing. Both races love it. And of course, a lot of rooting for the Filipino, for the Mexicans, and whatever. That made a great fight.
So everybody's interested. Sometimes one small car like that get into six persons to get in, just to get in there and see the fight. We only paid about from $1 to $1.50 each to get in.
They like to see you. So they drive all night just to go see the fight. And like they're you fight in San Francisco, they're from Salinas, Stockton, Sacramento,
prisoner from Imperial Valley, from Stockton, from Santa Maria, all over California. They come around and see that famous boxer, especially Espinidado and young Tommy and Cipriano Garcia.
They like you, they come and, you know, they've been from their shot to the punch up just to see the fight. There's no kidding. Filipino, they're funny. When they like you, they pawn their shot.
Like all boxing fans, the Filipinos each had their favorites.
He was the greatest fighter I've seen. Better than Villa.
Better?
Better than Villa. Dempsey? Dencio Cabanera? Better than Villa. Yeah, he's the greatest.
My favorite fighter was the Dawson brothers.
Well, that I could remember is Cipriano Garcia. He's a welterweight champion.
All the fighters that I saw, that speed, they do one of the best.
Sometimes like Garcia, Cipriano Garcia.
It had to be Maxi Dacosta. Maxi, I think, was my favorite because he more represented the Filipino, the average Filipino for me.
Speedy Dotto won the Pacific Coast Bantamweight Championship in 1932. He was known as the uncrowned champion of the world, although he floored champion Panama Al Brown 11 times in a 10-round non-title fight. He would never get another title shot from the champ. He was one of the highest paid Pinoy fighters of the day, commanding up to $5,000 per fight and making $350,000 during his career.
He was a great action fighter. Speedy always gave the people their money's worth.
That's one thing with that Speedy Dado. He just like a dog when he fought. He's clever and everything, fast.
He lived the life of a celebrity during his career, associating with movie stars of Hollywood and being voted as one of the world's 10 best-dressed men by Esquire magazine.
There were a bunch of cars there, fancy cars, Mercedes and all these fancy Rolls Royces and all that. And we looked into the window of one car, and I recognized Speedy Dado. He was sitting there, and alongside him was Mae West, the movie actress. We were watching one of the greatest fighters in the world, Speedy Dado, not in a boxing ring, but in the back seat of a car. And they weren't punching.
Unfortunately, Speedy lost all of his money to the fast life with racetracks and card games.
He ended up selling magazines up here at the Olympic Auditorium. You know, they liked him and all that, but he was such a great guy. Everybody used to buy a magazine from him. So he made good money out of it. You know, the magazines were 10 or 15 cents. Oh, they just give him a dollar, you know. So he was making money. But that's a hell of a way to end up. Everybody loved him, you know.
Boxing was also a way to make a quick buck for many Filipino laborers. Hordes of young Filipinos, faced with the heat of the fields and the filth and overcrowding of city hotel rooms, turned to boxing as a way out.
Professional prize fighting tends to attract, you know, people from the bottom of the ladder. And there was no one lower on the West Coast than Filipinos in the 1930s. No one.
The job they get is, I tell you, driver, cook, a houseboy, or a janitor.
Could get a job as a dishwasher, busboy. The highest is that what you call cleaning in the hotel. Well, in the year 1932, I already started getting 15 cents an hour, 20 cents an hour. But first time I arrived here is 10 cents an hour out in the country. Before, in those days, a lot of Filipinos are interested because If he fight six round, he could get over $100 already. Especially he's going to go on main event, he could get from $100 to $150 for 10 round fight.
It was also a way for, how can I put it, the lower echelon, the lower classes of stepping up into a world that was not easily accessible to them. Boxing was easy money, fast money. Well, now you're talking about young men, and they wanted the flair of life. Okay, and so if you boxed and then made any kind of money at all, then you got the money, you got the clothes, you got the women, you got the lifestyle, and of course that was very attractive for a young man.
After nearly three colorful decades and dozens of flashy fighters, the great era faded. Immigration changes and socioeconomic changes of World War II combined to end the recruitment and development of the Pinoy boxers.
Most of these guys had come over in the 20s and 30s. After the passage of the Philippine Independence Bill in the 1930s, Philippine migration to the United States was cut off, essentially. I mean, there was a token of 50 a year allowed into the U.S., but you didn't get that young blood back in to replenish the ranks of Pinoy boxers.
Strife in the Philippines during and after the war cut the popularity of boxing to an all-time low.
We didn't have access to reaching back in the Philippines and bringing the boxers over anymore, you know, because the Philippines was occupied during the entire war.
Here in America, opportunities seldom available before the war began to open up for the Pinoys.
As a consequence, a single young Filipino male didn't have to go into boxing as a potential source of getting some quick money. He now had avenues of the other industries that were closed to him before, such as the shipyards. They were still going great guns. The aircraft factories still needed people.
If you've got a chance to do something else aside from be a professional boxer, you'd be foolish not to be that something else. It isn't an easy way to make a living.
So as the Ducosan brothers faded, boxing as a large attraction also faded as far as Filipinos were concerned.
After the great era faded in the late 1940s, Pinoy boxing fans would see only occasional flashes of brilliance over the next 40 years. There were certainly champions to come, but it truly was during the great era when Filipinos passionately rallied for their heroes and for themselves. Through their heroes, the Filipinos were victorious, and the great era lives on in their memories.
A tremendous finale to this rugged 15-rounder.
Is it any wonder, then, that one of the quickest ways to a Manong's heart is to talk fights and fighters? I have an old and revered uncle who, in a burst of uncommon enthusiasm, avidly described a favorite champion. He rose on ancient and uncertain legs and demonstrated what he'd seen. Slip, jab, jab, cross. Strong, he said excitedly. Fast, clever. I smiled, and so was he, I thought, as were his compadres, as were they all.
Someday soon, I hope that they will come back. They need the Filipino boxers. They need them.
There's no adequate way to describe the kind of magic and the vibes that were there. Just, wow, boy, this is a big day.
It's an untapped source of pride.
It was a very romantic, very significant part of Filipino American history.